of the crew. The rest receive small amounts each time they are called out. But the men do not think of money once they are at sea under the orders of their coxswain. Nevertheless, a great deal of money is needed. The boats must be kept in perfect condition at all times. New boats constantly have to be built. All expenses are covered by voluntary contributions. Coins of all denominations are put into the collection boxes of the lifeboat institution. Many a check, be it large or small, is gratefully received. In wills, too, money is left for the lifeboat service. And because of all these voluntary contributions and the time given by coastguards and crews, 84,000 lives have been saved. We visited the St. David's lifeboat station on the St. Justinian Head on the most westerly corner of Wales to get to know the crew of the Sunny Moor. The men live and work about 2 miles from the coast in Europe's smallest city. At first, the visitor is surprised, as he sees nothing but farms and cattle. St. David's proudly carries the name of city, thanks to its cathedral, founded in the 12th century. At the organ sits Dr. Saw. Dr. Saw is a doctor of music, and has always tried to keep the cathedral a living monument of cultural life throughout his years as choirmaster and organist. The cathedral was always a goal for pilgrims, for it was said that 2 pilgrimages here equaled 1 to Rome. Maya laid the foundation stone of the present church in 1180. Its walls were built on the foundations of the monastery chapel, built by St. David himself roughly 700 years earlier. St. David, the patron and first bishop of Wales, died in 600, according to one account, at the age of 147. This small shrine hangs on the west wall and holds the relics of St. David. The organist is the honorary secretary of the crew of the Sunny Moor, and for the last 35 years has been responsible for the calling out of the lifeboat. His other great interest being the long history of his church and his town, which has always been a meeting place for kings, princes, and knights. William the Conqueror, Henry II, Edward I, and the most recent royal visitors were Queen Elizabeth II and the Duke of Edinburgh in 1955. Peace did not always reign round the cathedral. Armour clanked, pirates raided, and Vikings lay in wait along the coast. An earthquake shook St. David. Once the heavy tower collapsed as water undermined its foundations. At the side of the present cathedral stand the ruins of the old monastery in which St. David lived during the first century. Well-loved buildings in the town, the monastery's water mill. It belongs to this day to the resident bishop, and those who want to use it have to pay rent. There is a modern electric mill available, but this one is much better, and the opinion of the miller, Di Lewis. No, it has to be the old one. The solid wheels made from apple trees have turned and creaked for 500 years. Only when the thermometer drops to below freezing does Di Lewis look sadly at the icicles on the main wheel and wanders across to the new mill to press, with distaste, the buttons of the 20th century. Became coxswain of the Sunny Moor in 1956. He was awarded the Bronze Medal of the Royal National Lifeboat Institution for gallantry the same year. Di Lewis has many interests. A reliable and energetic coxswain, a miller who knows how to grind the finest flour with the apple wheels and who is also the only one who really knows how to maintain the mill, and the happiest man in the town when he sings to his one-man orchestra of guitar and drums. He is a lobster fisherman who makes his special lobster pots from homegrown reeds, pots that are in great demand with his fishing friends. Dr. Saw brought the Sunny Moor to St. David's in 1936. The lifeboat did valuable service for more than 25 years before being replaced by a newer boat. And Dr. Saw told us he wanted to retire from his post as honorary secretary with the new boat's arrival. George Jordan knows every knot and bolt on the Sunny Moor. He has been its mechanic for over 20 years. It is his duty to have boat and engine always at the ready. He used to be a ferryman. In those days his cargo was cows. He ferried the cattle from St. David's to the outer islands with the lush, sweet young grass and brought them back in the autumn. Since the Sunny Moor has been stationed at St. David's, over 200 lives have been saved from sinking ships or from the sea. There is room for nearly 100 survivors on board, although she is less than 50 feet long and about 12 feet in the beam. The mechanism which keeps the boat at the same angle as the launching slope is tested at regular intervals. Each time she puts to sea, it is like a new launching, more or less dramatic according to the height of the tide. Di James, the farmer, is the St. David's crew's second mechanic. He has held his position for 7 years without missing a single call. Di James is also the most eligible bachelor for miles around. Together with his younger brother, he runs his farm, Flamilta, which means watery land. Flamilta is one of the largest farms around St. David's, and although its house is 500 years old, it is still called the new farmhouse, for the older house stands beside the new, a ruin. Everything in St. David's seems centuries old. But something new is happening. In Basil Davis's yard, fishing and pleasure boats are being built. Basil Davis is radio operator in the Sunny Moor. He is an experienced sailor, having served with the Royal Navy. His gay young wife often pulls his leg by reminding him of his prowess at Shove Halfpenny. In his time, he was reputed to be the uncrowned champion of Bombay at the game. Valerie is expecting their first child.
Your lunch is ready.
Fear, when her husband is out with the boat, is unknown to her. Henry Griffiths is the youngest member of the crew. He was only 17 when, 3 years ago, he was first allowed to go out with the boat. When he was 9, he wound himself into a flag and stowed away in the Sunny Moor. The boat was called out. He emerged to help in the driving rain. A surprised Dr. Saw could do nothing but to push him back below deck. He reckoned that it would either kill or cure Henry once and for all. His father, Ivor Griffith, has been with the boat for 40 years. And to this day, he takes up his position during every launching. Henry's grandfather has been a member for 48 years. It has become a family tradition that the father leaves his place in the boat to the son.
Hear the trumpet flash, I'll be coming on, I'll
are not many places of amusement in St. David's. At the end of the day, there is a glass of beer, and time again, the miller, with his wry humour, is the one to get things going. One almost forgets that these men, who smile and listen to the sing-song, have their coxswain in front of them. This man, happily playing his one-man band, is the same man whose curt commands they follow to the letter at sea. About 2 miles away, the Coast Guard keeps his lonely watch. The Atlantic is constantly guarded. Sign of a possible mishap is reported by telephone to Dr. Saw, who then has to make his decision, to launch or not to launch. For some time now, the Coast Guard has been watching a small fishing boat. It is in danger of being caught in the surf and smashed against the cliff. It looks serious. Help is needed. After working out the position of the boat, he lights a smoke signal. For the two fishermen, this means it's all right. They realize we are in danger. Then he dials the organist's number.
Right, we will launch. Fire the maroons.
Explosions are heard far and wide. The call to the crew, no matter what you may be doing at this moment, leave everything and come. Launching is routine. The operation goes like clockwork, and it is exactly 15 minutes after firing the first rocket that the Coast Guard makes radio contact with the boat.
Hello, St. David's Coast Guard. Hello, St. David's Coast Guard. This is St. David's Lifeboat calling. St. David's Lifeboat calling. Are you receiving me, please? Over. Hello, St. David's Coast Guard. Hello, St. David's Coast Guard. St. David's Lifeboat is flying. We have now launched on service. Have you any further instructions for us, please? Over to you.
The Sonny Moore will not be left out of sight. The crew concentrates and scans the sea. There is no rain or gale today. Nevertheless, the fishermen got into trouble because the motor of their boat broke down. The helpers know that it is drifting nearer and nearer towards the rocks, and that a couple of oars and a sail are not enough to get it away. If they come too late, it could cost the fishermen their lives. A lifeboat has to be able to get to those places where other boats are helpless. Dangerous rocks, surf, gales and darkness are the conditions under which she often operates. Danger is the reason for her launching. Bailing. The boat has been sighted to starboard. Sunnymore has been guided by her radio to the spot where the two fishermen have been waiting since the smoke signal. This time they are men from their own town. Tomorrow it might be a French freighter, a Greek tanker, or a German cargo boat that could be in difficulty. The Coast Guard on the St. Justinian Head will continue to keep watch on his piece of the Atlantic, will, in case of an SOS, notify the organist of the St. David's Cathedral. The miller, the farmer, and all the others will assemble on the firing of the Maroons. They will help. They will do it freely. They will not ask the nationality or colour of the victims, nor query the force of the wind. Quick nip of rum and they feel better already. The Sunnymore will bring their small boat safely back to St. David's.